刚刚最后呢，仁波切又重复了一次，精进的特质就是越赢一切的善功德。那么，能够精进的话，不停的供养，不停上供下化，就是不停的净化一切，不停的供养诸佛菩萨，不停的净化众生的障碍。
So next are the parameters of meditation, meditative concentration, and then.
接下来是讲养那个禅定跟般若智慧的六度。
Speaks about the insight that is grounded in calm abiding. So now regarding, especially regarding the parameter of wisdom, actually, that can be.Explained by the great scholars for many days, actually, the Prajna Paramita, the perfection of wisdom, is one of the most important scriptures of study. So it can be explained very extensively, and I will just explain that in brief. Now this shamatha, this calm insight, which is grounded in calm abiding,what must happen is that we must attain this autonomy of freedom where we are able to abide at will. And so you can place the mind in its natural state and then stay there. So that's the kind of freedom, that of self-control that must be attained. And so why is it that we lack this control over our mind?Now, it is because whatever afflictive emotion and thought arises in the mind, we are completely overtaken by the force of that affliction. So we become completely controlled by it. It is said all freedom is happiness, and all lack of freedom or being controlled by other is the cause of suffering. So these thoughts and afflictive emotions are like the seeds of a flower that we accumulate in our mind. And later, then they are those karmic winds that we are bound to follow, that will take us. So, for example, anger arises, you become overtaken by the anger, it controls you. Then you engage in all sorts of activities with your body and speech. You accumulate karma. You're controlled by the hatred, the anger. You have no self-control. Now, here, shamatha, insight, which is grounded in calm abiding, refers to attaining this stability of not becoming controlled. So ideally, you understand the nature of the mind. You have realized that the nature of mind is like space. Or in Dzogchen it is referred to as the original purity. Whether it is Mahamudra or Dzogchen, we are speaking about the true natural state of the mind. And in order to realize the space-like nature of the mind, first of all it must become free from clouds, a cloud like a cloud-free sky. And again, there is much to be explained along those lines. And I have not myself studied that so much on an intellectual level, so I don't know how to eloquently perhaps explain that. I'm just really speaking from my own personal experience of that. So the point here is that thoughts must be pacified, first of all. But that doesn't mean that no thoughts arise. Thoughts will still arise in the mind, but they must not affect the mind, so you don't follow those thoughts. And then when you rest within that thought-free state, which doesn't grasp at thoughts, then you recognize Mahamudra or Vipassana. You know, you gain this insight in the nature of the mind, which is then like a cloud-free sky. Lord Chipnam Sungan has said, unless the clouds of the thoughts obscuring the sky of the mind itself do not vanish, the luminosity of the planets and stars, the luminosity of the two planets and stars, which are the two kinds of knowledge, will not emerge. So the two kinds of knowledge will emerge when the clouds of thinking is cleared away from the mind itself. So there are these two kinds of knowledge are the knowledge, the wisdom that realizes things as they are, and then the knowledge that knows all the things in their extent, everything that exists. So it refers to the relative and ultimate knowledge. And on an ultimate level, there is no contradiction. But I, again, do have that fault of not knowing to explain that very clearly in words. That is why we have also Kenpo Tenzin, who can explain that to you very well, the nature of calm abiding and special insight. Now, he has studied the scriptures on that, and there are many disciples who have an interest in this field of knowledge. Very many intelligent disciples are interested in knowing about that and hearing about those commentaries. And then there's also those like myself who just like to practice. And so for them, there's also many like that. And so for them, then there is me who shares just some personal experiences.
接下来讲这个禅定跟般若的这个六度当中的这两个度，那这都是以止为基础而来修观的。 那么如果说是一般的大学者呢，可以花很多天的时间来讲那我们知道般若经是在佛教里面非常重要的这个经典，但是因为我自己学识的限制，那我只能很简单的说根本上呢，修止就是让我们的心得到自由，可以任意，可以任意让自己受控制。那我们的心之所以没有自由，这是因为我们被烦恼所控制的。那当我们得到自由的时候，是可以感到非常快乐的，因为我们不再被烦恼所苦，再被烦恼所控制。当我们被烦恼所控制的时候，我们就好像被夜风所吹动一样，升起的内心升起的烦恼心、嗔心啊，那产生嗔恨啊，那让这些情绪、这些烦恼来控制我们。那如果说在我们有修止的话，我们内心是稳定的，就不会被这种气息、这些业风、这些烦恼所控制。大圆满讲的是这清净本地，那么大手印讲的是心性本性，这都是讲的都是一样的，根本上是像一个无云的晴空一般的境界。那我根本我自己是没有什么经验，没有什么学识的，不知道要如何适当的来讲这种境界，这是我自己的过患。但是我知道呢，这是一种根本上是一种基本上是一种无念之心从止息开始，那么无云的一种晴空。那吉天松公祖师过去也曾讲过说，除非这个像乌云一样的念头不再遮住的，像天空一样、虚空一样的心性，我们是见不到星球的光明的。那么这种这个星球的光明代表的是我们的智慧、我们的知识，包括的一切片智跟一切种智。那我们要透过修止、修观来长养我的智慧。那么我自己因为学识的限制的没办法多讲，但是天津堪布呢在这方面应该可以跟大家很仔细的讲解。在座有一些有大智慧的学生对这方面的佛学理论也很有兴趣，也可以去学。那我自己因为我自己的限制，我只能专注在修法。那这种智呢，也分成相对的层次跟究竟的层次，这两个层次可以来讲。所以二十九偈是以知具集之圣观，能尽摧灭诸烦恼，远离无色界四处修禅定是佛子行。第三十偈，若无智慧以五度，不得圆满菩提果，故具方便离三轮，修智慧是佛子行。
So, just regarding this verse that Bhajikdan Sumgyal from before, this is like the culmination of the six paramitas. And in the beginning, it all starts with, as before, the difficulty of finding a precious human birth and so forth, all the stages of the path. All of these stages of the path up until this point are actually for the sake of cultivating shamatha, calm abiding, a meditative state. So of course, ultimately, the goal is to attain enlightenment. In order to attain enlightenment, the Buddha said, completely tame your own mind. So this means purify your own mind. Even though the Buddha also said all beings are actually Buddhas, they still have to purify their mind. And we do that by practicing, accomplishing shamatha, a state of calm abiding. And this pacifies the confusion in the mind. According to the path of individual liberation, the afflictions are abandoned. In the bodhisattva path, they are transformed. So all of these are only a method to achieve a state of calm abiding, to not become controlled by the afflictive emotions. And in the individual liberation, one recognizes first the fault of the afflictive emotions. But in brief, it is all for the sake of achieving the state of calm abiding, to realize the mind after that. Because what's the ultimate fruition of calm abiding? It then leads into vipassana, or this special insight, seeing the nature of the mind, the true nature of the mind that is devoid of self and other. And this is when the consciousness transforms into primordial wisdom. So for as long as we don't see the true nature of the mind, we see a duality of self and other. And at that time, we refer to that mind as the consciousness. Consciousness projects outward and discerns various external objects. But it doesn't look inward, and it doesn't know its own true nature. And Milarepa actually explained clearly the difference between the consciousness and primordial wisdom. So what is the difference? Sentient beings who have not realized the nature of mind have a consciousness. We all have a consciousness. Whoever has a mind has a consciousness. And that consciousness perceives the duality of self and other. And then there is wisdom. There is the wisdom deities, for example. It is that within the expanse of primordial wisdom, all the Buddhas are one. When one realizes the nature of mind, one realizes that samsara and nirvana are indivisible. So that is what one realizes finally. Even if we cannot understand it on a large, vast scale, what we need to understand is self and others are not separate. In the Samantabhadra prayer, for example, this is referred to as the single basis. So it is the true nature of the mind. Now, regarding the difference between the consciousness and wisdom, when one accomplishes calm abiding, one gains insight into the nature of the mind, or vipassana. So at the time when there is consciousness, consciousness discerns various objects and also various afflictive emotions that arise, virtuous and non-virtuous thoughts and so on. But there is clinging, a belief in the true existence of whatever appears, and one labels them. No one gives them certain attributes. And so a feeling arises, and one completely indulges in that feeling, believes that this is how it is, believes in the truth of that feeling, that experience, and either thinks that it's true or it is not true. So the six kinds of feelings or sense sensations cause, grasping at them, cause the mind to solidify into this solid entity that actually doesn't exist. Even though the mind is insubstantial, it becomes like this solid thing due to the clinging fixation to our experiences. So at times we are distracted by pleasurable experiences of bliss. We cling to them and we are distracted. And then when it is taken from us, often we cannot bear that and even commit suicide. So that kind of mind who experiences all of that cannot actually be seen, and yet it has all of these experiences and feelings. So these feelings become so solid because of our grasping or belief in their true existence. Someone who realizes the nature of non-duality knows that all of this is just an illusion. Actually, there is only this one mind. There might be a diversity in bodies, but there is only one mind. That's actually the first thing to understand, the non-dual mind. And that is what insight vipassana realizes, the non-dual mind. So meditation is a skillful means to pacify all these thoughts and fixations in the mind. And one good method to do that is the meditation called the four kinds of placing of one's mindfulness, the four kinds of mindfulness in brief. And actually, Kenpo Denzi Rinpoche can explain that very clearly to you. Again and again, I'll request him to teach that to you. Because in the beginning, for a beginning practitioner, if we don't use these tools, like those four kinds of mindfulness, to reflect upon, it will be very difficult to deal with our thoughts that arise in the mind. That is why these teachings are very beneficial. So in brief, when it comes to shamatha, calm, abiding, it's not about rejecting thoughts. We can't really reject our thoughts, but we let them dissolve naturally, just like a wave from water.
之前吉天松公祖师所讲的寄送呢，这跟我们修六度也很有关系的。我们首先知道人生难得的道理，那么我们顺着一切道次第修行的阶段，接下来修止，那么究竟呢能够得到证悟。那佛陀过去曾讲说，我们修行就是要自尽其意，也讲了众生本为佛，只为客乘者。我们透过修止跟修观来净化我们自己内心的染污。别解脱圣主要是用避免或者是压制的方法、克制的方法来对治烦恼。那么菩萨圣的修行是用转化的方法。那么我们现在要做的是以先修止的前提来观心，这种内观，我们观到见到心性的真性，无他本处智的状态。只要我们不见心性的话，我们内心都是按照意识心而走，有内外的差别，那么不能往内去观，而见到外在的一切现象、一切万事万物而知其为实。所以弥勒巴祖师过去曾经讲过说，未见心性者有意识，也就是有自他的分别，在本初智的境界当中，诸佛是等同的。在这个究竟地的状态之下呢，轮回跟涅槃是不分的。那么我们即使没有办法了悟这个道理，也起码应该知道说，究竟来讲自他是不分的。那么这在普贤王如来祈愿文里面有讲一机的道理，一个基底的道理，一机。那么我们在修止能够让我们的心性有所了悟，我们一般凡夫的意识心是帮助我们分辨一切的外物，比如说善恶好坏等等。在这样子分辨了知之后呢，常常凡夫会继续做的就是执着所见为实，而给予一些名相、一些标签，以所见为实，不知道真或会非真。那么我们自己的心因为这些执着而慢慢凝固了，我们却不知道说心本来是抓不到看不到的。那么但是凡夫还是执外相为实，追求这个愉悦的快乐，而不能够忍受痛苦，甚至到因为种种的境界的考验呢，觉得这个痛苦实在太真实了，而没有办法逃避，而想要自杀。那么我们都常常认为感觉自己的觉受就是真实的，变非常的这个心性变得非常的牢坚固，像冰块一样，那么没有办法看到一切的，事实上一切都是幻象的，心是唯一的，没有二的。那透过内观帮助我们了解唯心唯一无二的道理，禅修呢是透过正念让它去掉直习我们内心的这个执着。
Grounded in calm abiding. So a sign that one has attained insight, vipassana, is that one's ability to transform afflictive emotions into wisdom. And so if we can't transform them, then we have not attained vipassana. So we realize the true nature of the afflictive emotions, which actually happens on really on the secret mantra path. So according to individual liberation and the bodhisattva path, without rejecting the afflictions and without even transforming them, they're directly recognized and thereby transformed into wisdom, primordial wisdom. And so that really is the view of vipassana that is grounded in shamatha, calm abiding. Then it says, knowing this, cultivate meditative concentration that purely transcends the four formless absorptions. So those four formless
远离无色界四处。
First, there is the absorption called infinite space. So first you meditate and you look at the nature of the mind, and this space-like experience arises. You feel that, oh, mind is really like infinite space. So there is this very subtle grasping that is present. You enter in a very subtle grasping of conceptualizing, thinking that mind is really like infinite space. And although it is true that the nature of mind is infinite like space, it becomes an obscuration to really realizing the nature of the mind, because we cling or we grasp, we have this concept of mind is like infinite space. And that is why the consciousness is not yet completely liberated into primordial wisdom. So the consciousness is the one who creates all of samsara and nirvana. So then one lets go of that grasping that is like space, but then one realizes this consciousness is just so vast, it creates all of samsara and nirvana. Consciousness is infinite. And so that's then the next grasping that arises, this concept of thinking consciousness is infinite, it really is infinite. And while it is infinite, the concept of it, grasping as this concept, is still a grasping thought. So that's the second absorption, infinite consciousness. And then transcending that fixation, one moves up to the third absorption, which is nothing whatsoever. For example, in Mahamudra, we are told, without a single thought, look decisively at the ultimate nature of the mind. So then one might think that it is just fine if I, this being said, it is fine if I just stay there without thinking anything. And even that in itself is a very subtle form of grasping. This also is a concept. So then you realize that and you transcend that concept too. And you come to the fourth absorption, which is called neither existing nor non-existing. So then that again is an understanding that is based on those words that one has heard. For example, the words as explained according to the Madhyamaka, the middle way, that tell you don't grasp at the existence of things and do not grasp at the non-existence of things. So don't grasp at existence or non-existence, it's neither. So then you think that I can just stay without grasping at either existence or non-existence. And then again, because it's based on this intellectual understanding, you enter into a very subtle grasping. So now that grasping is extremely subtle, but you enter into this grasping, and therefore this grasping becomes an obscuration to your practice. It's a very subtle feeling. It is said, it is not appearances that bind you, but it's your grasping at them that bind you. So first we allow the mind, therefore, to settle down, so it becomes like pure water, so there is no grasping. And when there is no grasping, then a real understanding arises. But then the moment we begin to enter into grasping, even in a very subtle way, again, we cannot really understand the nature of the mind. And so this is really what we call this very subtle obscuration to omniscience, to knowing the true nature of the mind. And again, that's something that Kenpo Tenzin will explain to you more. So these are the four kinds of meditative, of formless absorptions. It is infinite space, infinite consciousness, nothing whatsoever, and neither existence nor non-existence. So these gradually may arise throughout one's practice. And then these are the kind of grasping thoughts that one might enter into. And so it says, knowing this, one should cultivate meditative concentration that purely transcends those four formless absorptions. This is the way of a bodhisattva. So even if you do not transcend them, even if you enter those four formless absorptions, it still actually leads to birth in the higher realms. It still, according to the Dharma, is considered to be a good quality. If you, for example, take birth as a god, like in the six realms, as a desire god, and so on. So you still find the qualities of the higher realms, but it still prevents you from attaining the ultimate state of enlightenment. So it does become an obscuration to the attainment of enlightenment. So this is as much as I can explain on that, just from my own personal experience.
那么我们有机会大家可以请问这个堪波天金来讲四种正念是哪四种正念，那么初学者呢如果对这个这些观念这些不清楚的话，难以处理内心的种种这个状态，那么我们所做的是当内心这个烦恼升起的时候要认知消融，而不是把它作意把它消灭。当然我们有内观的时候，我们就可以把烦恼转为般若，转为菩提，那见烦恼的这个本质。别解脱圣跟菩萨圣他们对治烦恼的方法是把它排拒，或者是说把它转化，但是那个金刚圣的做法也不排拒也不转化，就是直视，以直观的见地在直的基础上直视这些烦恼。那这边讲到是禅无色界四处有四种天，或者是四处定，就是空无边处定、事无边处定、无所有处定、非想非非想处定，或者是你可以讲空无边处天、事无边处天、无所有处天、非想非非想处天等等。那么在一开始呢，无色界的四处就是一种空是无边的，那这个空无边这个是非常维系的这种执着，当然这是真的，但是 当我们把它执为实的话，就会阻碍我们证得心性的本处智。
They do arise, so especially if one is a meditation practitioner, now these experiences will arise in our practice, but the point is now how do we deal with them when they do arise. So the point is to not neither reject them nor accept them, but to just remain still in meditation. So with each of those experiences that arises, each of those feelings that arises, actually these experiences often arise as a quality of calm abiding. They come along with calm abiding. They're connected to this aspect of stability of calm abiding. So the instruction is that when anything arises, grasping thought arises, it says that do not try to accomplish abiding, and do not try to reject the movements of the mind, the thoughts. So do not even engage in the most subtlest of thoughts, but also do not reject whatever arises. So you stay in this loose, natural state without thinking that a thought is something undesirable, I need to reject that. Just feel that whatever arises, let it arise. Let arise anything that may, but do not engage in it. Do not develop this fixation of like, I want this experience again and again, for example. Don't develop that kind of thought. And it, whatever else arises, don't try to reject an undesirable thought. So not rejecting it means to let it be as it is, just naturally. It arises and it will go away on its own, just like a wave from water. Through habituation, so later on, as you keep practicing, eventually it will just naturally dissolve. So it begins with understanding that and knowing how to do that. Then it becomes an experience, secondly. So then you practice that and it becomes a personal experience. You experience how when the thought arises and you just let it be on its own naturally, you observe how it dissolves on its own into itself, just like a wave dissolving into the water. So that's the experience that takes practice for a long time. And that leads to realization. And that is, of course, a little bit difficult in the beginning. It requires a long time of practice. And sometimes also it happens when a really authentic guru with compassion comes together with an authentic disciple with devotion. And sometimes there is no doubt within the mind. But sometimes even the subtlest of doubts naturally arises in the mind. And then you just let it be naturally. And that's the only way you can really deal with it. And you have to let it be naturally and allow it to dissolve on its own. It is very difficult to instantly just make it disappear. So it requires some time and practice. So here, transcending the four formless absorptions, in brief, the instruction here is do not reject what arises and do not try to accomplish deliberately abiding. Just let it all be. Even the slightest sensation of feeling that arises, let it all be as it is and allow it to dissolve on its own.
那么我们知道我们的本性是超越这个轮回跟涅槃的，它是无量，虚空是无量的，我们的意识也是无量的，那么为何在这种无量无边的情况之下还会有所执呢？这个就是我们要去超越的。所以从空无边处定到的事无边之处定，再来无所有处定，因为感到一切皆空，再来再继续超越的话，也非想非非想，不有不是有，也不是没有，这是一种中观的境界，不只有也不只空。那么这是一种，但是在这个状态之下，如果觉得这个才是对的话，这也是非常维系的这种执着，因为这种还非常维系的执着束缚着，那么了知慢慢升起，还是会障碍我们正道究竟的心性的。那么如果说我们进入到这种四禅天，那不能转化，不能超越的话，不能证到究竟的涅槃，或者是得到究竟的证悟的话，因为他的善业善因缘还是可以受生为天人的，但只是说不能进入究竟的证悟，所以呢我们还是称它为阻碍。
So the view of Vipassana or special insight is related to the single-pointedness of Mahamudra, this the stage of single-pointedness. Regarding that, Milarepa had said, when you remain in the clarity of mind without grasping, allowing all thoughts to dissolve into themselves, then you recognize the spontaneously existing luminous state, and this clarity which recognizes that. And that is the completion of single-pointedness. So clarity, remaining with clarity, is to be fully aware of the thought-free, empty, space-like mind. To clearly know that the mind is empty, that is clear consciousness. And so that is what we call this unity of clarity and emptiness. Unity means that they are not separate, indivisible. So that is the nature of clarity is emptiness. The nature of emptiness is clarity. Smaller example is, it is like a fire flame. And the larger example is, it's like space. So even though the nature of the mind is like space, we don't recognize that. And if we don't recognize that, we are sentient beings. The Samantabhadra prayer says, if you recognize it, you are a Buddha. Not recognizing it, you are a sentient being wandering in samsara. So when you recognize it, then you know, now I have seen it. This clarity and emptiness, clear and empty awareness. You recognize it clearly when you let go of all grasping at any true existence of whatever arises, and you just abide within clear awareness. And even in just an instant, you glimpse the space-like nature of the mind. So at that moment, when you abide within this space-like state, there is no thought at all of it either being this or being or not being that. There is not even the slightest feeling of it is infinite space or it is infinite consciousness. And so this lack of grasping comes from allowing the mind to rest naturally. And so that is what was meant with the spontaneous existence of the mind, which is the self-arisen nature of the mind. For example, this is how it is referred to in the 7 verses of supplication to Tara for protection. The self-arisen mind that is non-dual primordial wisdom, it says in that text. So a sign that the mind is self-arisen is that it is like space, and within space there is no duality or division. Wherever you go in the universe, there is no duality in space. So this actual view of vipassana or insight into the nature of the mind arises when you let go of all grasping whatsoever.
那么是禅定是有可能可以达到的，但是重点不是不去排斥，也不去接受他们，不迎不拒。那么持续在这个禅定当中，这个是修止而有的这个功德。那么当有一切的升起的时候，也不要去执着，不要去想它，也不要去回拒它这些念头的升起。那么不迎不拒，所以不要去注意说我这是念头是不好的，我要去消灭它，或者说我要有这种禅定的经验，这种需求，就是要做的就是任运，让它自然而然在这个本来的状态当中自然的，那么这些念头究竟会消融，那么成为一个个人的这种禅修的这种体验跟经验，那么它就可以自己消融，就好像波浪终究会融入海一般这就是可以获得证悟了。那么这种一开始或许是很困难的，当我们有真实的上师跟真诚真实前进的弟子，中间没有任何疑惑，即使有一些些微的疑惑升起，也是任运让它自己消融，不要去排拒一切的升起，也不要执着一切的安住，任运让它自己消融，这个是内观的建立。 见地，就像大手印所讲的，以心明日把主事当讲说，当安住心中的明性无所执，让一切的念头之消融，保持无念清明的状态，这就是意义，这就是如虚空的心性明空双融的状态。
Despite our practice, still those subtle grasping thoughts do arise in our mind. It is because we have not eliminated self-grasping. Of the four maras, this is referred to as the mara of self-conceit. So for as long as there is this demon of self-grasping present,we will always develop all sorts of doubts. So at this point, therefore, we must first make a greater effort in the training in bodhicitta. Bhatto Rinpoche had said that meditation is to unify, to join the empty mind with compassion. And that is the purpose of all meditation practices, starting with taking refuge and then on the path of altruism and cultivating bodhicitta. There is not a single fault that does not arise from self-grasping. So what Bhatto Rinpoche really said was that instead of making a great effort in meditating on emptiness, you should make a greater effort in cultivating compassion. And this is actually mentioned in many of the other scriptures as well. And so that is because when you cultivate compassion,the very nature of compassion is emptiness. So when compassion for others arises, at that moment you should look at the state of your mind. There is no concept of a self at that moment. So a moment when you think of others, you're not thinking of a self. And when this concept of a self arises, then you are not thinking about others. So that's the quality that the Buddha had realized.So practice or meditation means to unify the empty mind with compassion. And this is often also why many beginning practitioners grow tired of practice, even though they make the greatest effort in meditation and calm abiding and looking at the nature of the mind or vipassana. They still get tired of it because they lack the basis of love and compassion.So a true, authentic state of vipassana is one where you are free of any doubts. So first, you must have an understanding of this authentic vipassana, have a real understanding and trust in that. Secondly, you must gain an experience. That means you have to practice it over and over again in all your daily activities. You must train the mind. You must train the mindas the thoughts and the afflictions arise. And then finally, there is realization. And that is then through the training, through the experience, that leads into realization, which is an unchanging state. And at that point, no circumstance can affect you one or the other way any longer. For example, in the Vajrakilaya practice that many of you do, it says,May the fortress of the view be gained. So first, you understand the view. Then secondly, may the abyss of meditation be crossed. So that is, you cross the abyss of meditation or this dangerous path of meditation by applying the practice in your day-to-day activities. And then thirdly, it says, may the life force of the conduct be seized. So then, when understanding of that arises, when you apply things in your conduct, then it leads to realization and stability. So these words of the Vajrakilaya actually are very meaningful, and they really show the ultimate meaning of vipassana, or the insight into the nature of the mind. And so ultimately, what vipassana really is this perfection of wisdom.
你学了这些的，现在让我们领导接受的，告诉你，学了没呢？加入新
啊，我们要知道明性的明空的本明的本性为空，空的本性为明。 那么这用小的例子就可以用这个火焰来讲，那大的例子就是虚空来讲了。虽然心是像虚空而不能体认，所以众生就堕在轮回当中。这个是普贤王如来祈愿文所提到的，如果我们能够了解这个道理，就是能够成佛的。所以我们还要有内心当中有清明却又性空的这种觉知，一切的升起我们都把它安住在一种清明觉知的状态之中，是一种无念，没有一点点的觉受，没有无限的个概念，也是有无限的这个舒适，心就自然的安住，自然的这个本性的这个本质，自性的本质。在七救父度母里面，七原文里面有讲到自他自生的这个自生本觉的这个道理，空跟空是没有分说这边的空那边的空的，就像虚空是没有办法把它分开的，对任何都没有执着。那但是或许你会问说，为什么还是有很维系的这种执着呢？主要就是因为我们自己的这个我执，在我们讲到四魔的时候，有一个就是自七魔。那么还有一点疑惑，所以我们还要透过训练来长养我们自己的菩提心。巴楚仁波切讲说，与其花很多的精神力气去修这个寻找空性，不如去寻找悲心，因为禅定的定义就是空性跟悲心的总和。接下来是这个般若的这个若无智慧以五度不得圆满菩提果，故具方便离三轮修智慧是佛子行，这是第三十偈。
This is the way of a bodhisattva. So without wisdom, it is said, the other five perfections are just like being a blind person. So when you hear that, then you might think that, so all of the things I've practiced until now are just empty and mean nothing then. But that's also not true, because the 84,000 Dharma teachings are all taught in order to attain enlightenment.So that, in other words, means that they are only taught in order to realize this perfection of wisdom, all for that purpose. They are all a method for that to arise, like those three methods for bodhicitta to arise, where it has not arisen, to not let it decline, where it has arisen, and to further increase it. The method to further increase it is the practices of the secret mantra. And so all the practices,that all the paramitas are for the sake of finally realizing wisdom, to perfect wisdom. The Buddha had perfected wisdom, had realized the nature of the mind. Actually, the meaning of all of that is contained in the Heart Sutra, for example, the meaning of the perfection of wisdom. And actually, when you read it over and over again, then the meaning of that will really arise within your mind.The Heart Sutra, for instance, the perfection of wisdom speaks of emptiness. And so then when you read that, what falls apart are these fixations of things really exist, that's real. All these subtle and coarse thoughts that arise in our mind, even the subtle thoughts of just clinging to a very small thought and just thinking this is how it is, or to have certain doubts in the mind.For as long as we perceive a duality of self and other, there are doubts in the mind. And doubt itself is just a thought. So when you really understand the perfection of wisdom, when that is accomplished, then a sign of that is that all doubts will disappear. There's no more doubt. So it says, combined with skillful means. So as we mentioned before, there isthose three skillful means to make it arise, to not let it decline, and so on. But the actual skillful means is actually compassion. And when compassion arises, then self-grasping is naturally absent. So when real immeasurable love and immeasurable compassion arise, then then skillful means has been combined with wisdom. And so then combined with skillful means, one develops the wisdom that does not distinguish among the three spheres.
那本心的本质是空性，在刹那当中无我无他，这个是诸佛所证的空性的心，加上悲心，这个要把它同整起来。初学者在修止修观的时候，会觉得疲倦，这是因为悲心不够的关系。那么，我们要修行的这个阶段，就是要具有信心，再来天天训练，透过我们的心性禅修到。第三个阶段的证悟，透过经验训练而到定境，不再有疑惑等等。那么普巴金刚有讲到修行，叫愿我证得见地的城堡，跨过禅修的师地，行止的得到行止的生命力得以止息等等，这就是第三个阶段的证悟。心性的内光，这是一个般若的圆满。透过四无量心的慈悲心呢，我们的执着慢慢的减少减弱。当我们执着减少减弱的时候，我们可以看到他人的这个本质。如果从这个阶段这个状态来观他，那本质变空的，这是一种方便法。离三轮的智慧，一切轮回涅槃自他的差别都是无自性的，一切外相都是心的展现。当我们能够了认心的本质性的时候，我们可以知道这的一切都是心性的展现。当我们圆满的这一点，这就变成是般若的圆满。我八万四千种法门都是在菩提心当中，这就是在也包含在我们的究竟菩提山当中。对于这个相对菩提心是，要证得究竟菩提心的基础，因为它是证得究竟菩提心的，方便道路、方便法。就像我们皈依戒的时候讲，然后说 Top you know， 这就是道。那透过这个我们能够了知，能够证悟。那么没有智慧，如果没有智慧般若的话，其他五度都是变成虚无虚而不实。我八万四千种法教呢，都是要带领我们到证悟的境界，就是般若圆满。那么就像我们菩提心的祈愿，未生起者以令生起，这是别解脱乘；以生起者令不退，这是菩萨善；祈愿辗转更正上，这是金刚乘的祈愿。那么佛陀已经圆满的智慧，已经了悟知的心性，心性当中所讲的是一种圆满的智慧。我应该反复的念，让自己这种觉受自己的经验能够自然的生起。我们在一种空的境界当中，如果说有一种很维系的的念头在那里，那我们还是有一种自他的分别心，有这种很维系的这种疑惑。那如果我们真正的圆满般若智的话，我们事实上应该是没有疑惑的。那它的方便法门是什么呢？就是菩提心的三个阶段：未生起者令生起，已生起者令愿不退，祈愿辗转更增上，别解脱乘、菩萨乘到金刚乘的三个阶段。那么如果真的升起菩提心的话，那么方便法加上智慧，就是我们能够证到圆满的智慧的道路。好，中午休息。
Hey guys, I know everybody's like ready to go. I'm so late, I'm so sorry. Just a reminder that we have a 1:15 with Campo this afternoon, so please come with your questions. And for those of you that are getting ready to go, if you'd like to make offerings to the Lamas and need some change, please see the bookstore. Thank you.